Aviation and Birmingham, the association of which may not readily spring to mind. And if that's the case, my hope for this video is that it's a little bit of an eye-opener. This is a project I've wanted to get filmed there for a number of years, but just never got round to it. So I thought before I became too old and too grey to produce and present it, 2020 would be the year. Little did I know it'd take almost 7 months to complete, mainly due to the poor weather in January and February, and then, very understandably, the coronavirus lockdown restrictions and governmental guidelines that came into force towards the end of March, all of which contributed in slowing the process down. But as the saying goes, better late than never. And I really do believe this is my best way of trying to entertain you during this very difficult time, and not by singing you Come Fly With Me virtually from the front room. Just leaves me to say that I hope you all continue to stay safe, and of course that you enjoy watching the video. Welcome to a very different looking video from yours truly for 2020, the filming of which has proved challenging to say the least, through January and February storms and all the wind and rain. So today's definitely a case of making hay while the sun shines. It also gives me the opportunity to thank all of you who in your thousands have been watching the videos we produced, say over the last 12 to 18 months, and some of the lovely comments you've left on them too. I really appreciate it, so thank you very much indeed. Now this time, instead of driving around Lincolnshire or Bedfordshire or Yorkshire, I thought we'd choose a location and backdrop that was slightly closer to home. And the building behind me here is certainly that. In the Art Deco style, it's the original terminal and control tower that once served Elmdon Airport. Designed and built in the 1930s, in 2019 it celebrated its 80th anniversary, the reason it features in this video. And of course these days it shares the same site with Birmingham Airport. Opened on the 8th of July 1939, just a matter of months before the start of the Second World War. And indeed, during the Second World War, there were hundreds, if not thousands, of Lancaster bomber flights made from here, but not on bombing missions. A mystery? Well, not really, but as they say, that's another story. And that story being that the Lancasters that took off from Elmdon Airport had all been manufactured 18 miles away at the Austin Motor Works at Longbridge near Birmingham. But the runway at Longbridge was too short for the Lancasters to take off from. So the fuselage and wings and other sub-assemblies were loaded onto transporters and then taken by road to Elmdon Airport for final assembly in the Austin Aerosheds. The completed Lancasters were then towed by tractor along a road that was wide enough to allow them to cross a specially constructed bridge over a railway line. And then on to number two hangar that still survives today, that served as a flight shed. Taxi trials and air tests followed before finally taking off and leaving for their designated bomber squadrons. This rare image of Avro Lancaster NX792 is an authorised still photograph taken from a British Pathé film shot at Elmdon Airport, my best guess being between April and October 1945. Following VE Day and with the war in Europe over, the Lancaster appears to be halfway through having its European theatre of war green and brown camouflage overpainted in favour of the all-white heat-reflecting paint scheme to join the proposed Tiger Force in the war against Japan. The aircraft is towed out by tractor from number two hangar under the watchful eye of some of the flight shed's workforce. The photo also seems to show an attempt to disguise the flight shed from possible enemy aircraft flying overhead by painting a false facade of what appears to be a large house on the hangar doors. To watch the whole British Pathé film that also shows the Elmdon Airport terminal building itself, follow the link attached to this video. It's a fascinating insight that once again highlights the important role Elmdon Airport played during World War II. NX611 is a Longbridge Birmingham, Austin Motors built, Elmdon Airport assembled, 1945 Avro Lancaster bomber that has survived the passage of time, and is one of just 17 complete airframes left out of the 7,377 built during World War II. It now resides at the Lincolnshire Aviation Heritage Centre at East Kirkby, where it is being lovingly restored back to flying condition to hopefully become the third airworthy example. So maybe one day it will make a return flight to where it made its first flight, Elmdon Airport. Elmdon Airport itself has a very interesting World War II history. And if you know where to look, hidden away, there are clues to that history that still survive to this day. This battle HQ and bunker is located just yards away from a main road that runs alongside the airport. In all the times and years I've driven past this spot, until fairly recently, I had no idea that it even existed. So far, my attempts to find out who actually manned the bunker has provided very little in the way of facts. The local Home Guard unit used nearby Elmdon Hall, sadly demolished in 1956, as a base during World War II. But almost certainly it would have been the regular army that would have been called upon to engage the enemy from it. Although the likes of Captain Mannering and Corporal Jones from Dad's army, I'm sure, would have relished the opportunity.
Don't panic!
Overgrown and flooded now, it remains a visual reminder of the importance that was once attached to Elmdon Airport during the war between 1939 and 1945. Today on the old Elmdon Airport site, a few of the buildings from its past still remain. The airport hotel survives and is now a Holiday Inn, as does the 1960s multi-storey car park that is still earning its keep, and also provides an excellent vantage point for the many aircraft spotters and photographers. Up and away in my beautiful balloon. Somebody had a hit with that, you know, back in the 1960s. I can't remember who now. I reckon I could have sung that with Bill's band. Oh well, never mind. Back to the here and now. Now, while I'm here, it would be an absolute crime not to take a closer look at the exterior of this very, very special building. And the first thing I encounter, and in desperate need of a fresh coat of paint, is something I'm sure we're all very familiar with. Now this is interesting, this is of course the old post box. Apparently the next collection day is Tuesday. It doesn't say which week, which month, or indeed which year. And it hasn't always been in this position. If we look at this old 1960s black and white photograph, there it is, which is just over there. But it was obviously moved at some stage. I wonder when the last time this was actually used. If you know, leave a comment on the video. Look at that. Amazing. We move up and along the front of the building that managed to combine functionality with elegance. You know, I could almost hear myself running up these very same steps as a young lad in excited anticipation of getting that first look at the aircraft there on that day. The whole design of the terminal has that look of the old 1930s Odeon and Gaumont cinemas. The two side canopies to the terminal were designed to resemble aircraft wings, naturally. Look at that, just stunning. The terminal building's clock that seemed to work intermittently during the time spent filming there. And below that, the City of Birmingham's coat of arms. Its motto, forward. Strange, now on a building that in so many ways evokes memories of the past. The only regular flights made from the old terminal building these days are with the aid of feathers. How many journeys began by walking through these doors? They are a time portal, a passport to the past. I really appreciated being given the opportunity to get a little bit closer with the camera, as usually the terminal building itself is out of bounds. There's something very special about old black and white photographs. Especially if you can stand in the same place that they were actually taken. 20, 30, 40, 50, even 60 years ago maybe. Like this photograph, for instance. taken around about 1960-61. There's the old terminal building. Some of the cars of the day, Morris Minor, a couple of Fords. There's a Morris Minor van there, I think. Derby Aviation Limited. It's like looking back in time, isn't it? A couple of the people on the viewing platform there, looking out across the airfield, watching the aircraft take off. And they're still taking off and landing to this day. And the lovely old DC-3 Douglas Dakota. I love it. Now, sadly, I cannot show you the other side of the terminal building, or indeed its interior. But this wonderful 1960s Birmingham Airport guide booklet can. It has some superb period photographs in it. So with this, and along with some of the postcards I've collected over the years of Elmdon Airport, Birmingham Airport, they will show us what it used to look like in the 1960s. And we start our virtual tour with an aerial photograph of the airport and terminal buildings. Our journey continues past the duty meteorological observer, reading the temperatures in the instrument enclosure, through the gate and onto the original terminal building itself, where behind its stylishly designed rounded glass frontage and on the second floor was the Skyway restaurant that provided an excellent cuisine and a superb uninterrupted panoramic view of the whole airfield. For a lighter bite to eat, tea, coffee or soft drink, the restaurant on the first floor of the International Terminal Building would be your port of call. For a manly pint of beer, cocktail or maybe a baby sham for the ladies, you would visit one of the terminal building's bars. There were the various check-in and baggage handling areas, somewhere to sit, chat and relax while you waited for your flight. And in the main concourse, there was the Lloyds banking facility that was also on hand to arrange any foreign travel requirements. And the airport shop that sold souvenirs, books and toys. And then it was just a short walk out to your awaiting aircraft. These are passengers boarding a BEA Vickers Viscount. It would then be the responsibility of air traffic, whose members sat in the lofty height of the control tower to send you safely skyward and on your way. The 1960s control tower being a far cry from its more modern day equivalent. This is a post-war DC-3 Douglas Dakota of British European Airways, parked in front of the terminal building. But during World War II, when Elmdon Airport became RAF Elmdon, the scene back then would have looked very different indeed. And the most striking difference would have been seeing the terminal painted in its green and brown camouflage. Other points of interest here are, on the left, the RAF Dakota wearing its D-Day invasion black and white identification markings, and on the right, the Vickers Wellington bomber. Over the years, many DC-3 Douglas Dakotas operated out of Elmdon Airport. So to recognise this in 2004, a specially commissioned Dakota bust by Peter Whitehouse, representing the nose section of a DC-3 Douglas Dakota, went on public display. And it's a fine piece of work. But I could never understand why Elmdon Airport itself wasn't the chosen location for it, where it eventually ended up, several miles away from the place it's supposed to symbolise, still puzzles me every time I see it. Now, the last time I was here filming anything like this, unbelievably, was almost 40 years ago. Time flies. Back then, I used to use an old Super 8 cine camera. This cine camera. And I remember standing round about here and filming the terminal and the control tower and some of the aircraft that took off on that day too, into a clear blue sky, pretty much as it is today. And when they closed this building to the general public in 1984 and opened the new Birmingham International Terminal just across the way, I did some filming there too. And it had this very futuristic looking maglev rail system. And the cars used to float across the bridge, whirring away. It was almost like something out of a James Bond movie. And if you know your Bond films, You Only Live Twice, Sean Connery as 007. Well, fortunately, a little bit of that footage has survived. Quality-wise, it's not brilliant. But here it is. The yellow car, I think, is a Vauxhall Chevette launched in 1975. When's the last time you saw one of those? And that was the view you had from the terminal's viewing platform. And then it was onto the new Birmingham International Terminal. And there's the maglev rail car, a commercial world first for Birmingham. It used a form of magnetic levitation for propulsion, hence the name, maglev. If you have any memories or a story regarding Elmdon Airport, please do leave a comment on the video. Well, I've thoroughly enjoyed myself revisiting an old friend, this lovely old building. A building I've known since I was a boy. My father used to bring me here and we'd go up on the viewing platform over there and watch the aircraft taking off and landing. So many happy memories, and it's been really nice to include Dad's classic Wolseley in some of the video shooting photographs. He would have absolutely loved this. And the building, well, I believe in the not too distant past it attained listed building status, grade 2 I think, which is fabulous news. So let's just hope the powers that be give it the future it deserves, so more and more people can enjoy it for many more years to come. Oh, and by the way, if you have been wondering what happened to the trilby-wearing time traveller, and I'm not referring to Nicholas Lyndhurst in Goodnight Sweetheart, well, he just drove off and left without saying a word. Will we ever see him again? Only time will tell.
Now, if you don't mind, I've got a plane to catch.